step closer to hip hop and R&B music. HipHopLE.com.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the newest edition of What You've Been Missing. It's your man Odyssey, producer, MC, tuning in to Hip Hop LE. Much love. I've been good, very, very productive. I'm always an artist who has a lot on my plate, but that's the only way I like to work. I like to have what I call good stress, and right now I have lots of good stress. I'm a producer, MC. I'm originally from Washington, D.C., but I relocated to Brooklyn, New York. And I got my start, I guess, like many other artists. It was a hobby that turned into an obsession that turned into a career. It switched to a career, I'd say, in around 2004, when I landed my first track that I sold on Jazzy Jeff's album, The Magnificent. And that was the start of me actually understanding that I could make a living from music. And from that point on, I was courted by numerous independent labels. And fast forward to where I am today, slew of production credits and albums released, and lots of tours, but none in Asia, actually. But hopefully we can change that. I guess the type of music I make, you could put me in the category of, you know, your classic underground independent hip-hop people with the likes of Mos Def and Talib Kweli and The Roots and Common and artists like that, and even artists like Kanye West or Pharrell. Being as a producer and an MC, I have comparisons, of course, on both sides. And definitely that's the category that you would put me in. You would put me in a category of conscious hip-hop that's not necessarily about objectifying women or materialism or violence. It's more so a social and political commentary over a really good organic production. My parents influenced my music career very, very heavily, culturally more so than directly. My mother is African American from Washington, D.C., and my father is from Sudan. And he's from Khartoum in the north of Sudan. And the differences in the music that they listened to from their local areas were kind of smashed together with me in my house. I grew up listening to both. And I traveled a bit, quite a lot when I was younger, back to Sudan, and I came back to the States. So there's definitely remnants of my influence and my experiences always in my music. It finds its way in subconsciously. I don't have to actually intentionally say, I'm going to put this sound into my music. It just finds its way in. So my parents definitely opened me up to realizing there was a much larger world, and they gave me roots in soul music, and they also gave me roots in African music and Arab and Middle Eastern music, and the rhythms and the combination of all of them put together is kind of what I am and what I make. But depending on what part of Sudan you're in, and the part of Sudan where my family lives, it's a city called Omdurman, which is adjacent to the capital city, Khartoum. The Nile River is in the middle, and Khartoum sits on one side and Omdurman sits on the other. It's kind of like Brooklyn and Manhattan, and the rivers exactly the same. Like you can see one from the other. But in the north where they're living at, it's a pretty typical North African, Middle Eastern looking city. It's a desert, you know, lots of concrete houses. If you've seen any homes in Egypt or, you know, Tunisia or anywhere in North Africa or the Middle East, it pretty much looks the same as those. It's a mixture of all of those different cultures. You have indigenous Nubian rhythms, and then you have rhythms from the south of Sudan and their rhythms put together. You have rhythms from the Middle East, and you even find tidbits of reggae influenced in a lot of modern Sudanese music because of Ethiopia and the Rastafarian culture that was the relationship between Jamaica and Ethiopia, and Ethiopia is our neighbors. So a lot of reggae rhythms actually find themselves in modern Sudanese music. I started off as a rapper first, and I wanted to be self-sufficient and make my own beats so that I wouldn't have to rely on anyone else. And that started that path. And then I soon discovered that it was much easier to make a living in hip-hop as a producer than it is as an MC. Because as a producer, I can make 10 tracks and I can send them to 10 different artists and those 10 songs can come out at the same time. But as a lyricist, I can only come out with X amount of projects in 1 year. So it's just more lucrative to focus on production, but these days I've found a good balance at doing both, you know. I get asked the question of which one do I think I'm better in a lot. And honestly, my answer is it's 50-50 because one makes me want to do the other. Whenever I write like a really good rhyme, I'm so eager to go and make a beat. And whenever I make a really, really good beat, I'm excited to write a rhyme. So there's a healthy competition between the two and they constantly are bettering one or the other, you know. I really couldn't pick which one I like better because they both give me the same feeling and they both make me want to do the other. I never really stood back. I just noticed certain things along the way, you know. Suddenly you get walked into a club or you start making more money, or the biggest thing that made me realize it and it felt good was more people were calling me instead of me calling them. That was the thing that really made me realize that I was progressing in my career and heading in the right direction. You know, there was this transition from hunting down people to get placements on their albums and submitting material to those people calling me, asking me to give them tracks for their records or to be on their tours or to be on their radio shows or interviews. And it was that change that made me realize that I was becoming more known. And it, of course, it feels good, you know. I got introduced to Jazzy Jeff through a good friend of mine by the name of Kev Brown, who produced the majority of the Magnificent album for Jazzy Jeff. Kev and I come from the same area, and we came up musically together. Where we're from, there aren't a lot of people who are into independent underground hip-hop. So if you were into it, you started to know each other very, very fast. And we stuck together. And Kev knew Grap Lover, who was Pete Rock's brother, because he lives in Maryland also. So Kev played some stuff for Grap Lover, and then Grap played Kev's stuff for Pete Rock. Pete Rock played Kev's stuff for Molly Mall. Molly Mall played Kev's stuff to Jazzy Jeff. Jazzy Jeff called Kev. Kev went to Philly. Kev played my stuff for Jazzy Jeff. I went to Philly. Just connecting the dots, yeah. Yeah. It was an amazing experience, you know. I had an ultimatum given to me from my father that if I didn't have a commercial release by the time I was 21, that I had to stop doing music and I had to finish school and work for him and work for my dad's business. So this was right when I was 21 years old. And this was my last year to make a commercial release. And it happened just like that, you know? And it started my career. So it was a very, very special moment in time for me, you know? It's a great transition period. Yes, definitely. I went up to Philadelphia and I tracked out my song and recorded all the vocals there. And I frequented the Touch of Jazz quite often after that. But very soon after that, there was a decline in the music industry due to the transition from people buying music to people downloading music. You know, it was the Napster era. And it started to directly affect A Touch of Jazz and tons of other record labels and large studios. So right when I got my foot in the door with A Touch of Jazz, who had major label distribution, there started to become a decline in studio work and record sales. So people were cutting back, signing people. So just when I got my foot in the door there, it was put on hold. And that's how I went to the transition to working with independent record labels, because it was the only way to survive. Working with Halftooth was a great experience for me. It was my foundation in the independent record industry. It was a lot of trial and error, you know, and I was thankful for that opportunity. The first record that I put out for them, I was allowed to executive produce. So the first full-length album that I put out was a compilation, and I had already had executive production credits. So it started to help me shape an ear for A&Ring records, selecting artists, selecting beats and subject matter, who to place on what tracks, how to market them. And I got to learn a lot from that very first record that was released. And from that, I got to learn from a lot of mistakes as well. You know, Half-Tooth Records existed during the transition from physical purchases to digital purchases, from magazines to blogs. So a lot of labels didn't make it through that transition. And the reasons why is because they were continuing to pour tons of money into avenues that were shrinking instead of exploring the new avenues, because they didn't see the point in them yet. And I got to sit back and watch that. I got to sit back and watch tons of promotion money go into major magazines that, who knew, a year or two later wouldn't be exist anymore, and had to play catch up on what a blog was and how to solicit your music to a blog. So I was a fortunate person that I was at the right place in the right time to learn from the mistakes and see the advantages and apply them to the new formula for music industry. That transition destroyed a lot of labels and it ended a lot of careers. So the Half-Tooth years for me were very, very formidable years.
How about the diamond industry?
Sure. I'm a fan of so many different genres and subgenres of hip-hop. I like commercial hip-hop, underground hip-hop, West Coast hip-hop, down south, etc. And one of the forms of hip-hop that's really close to my heart is classic 1990s boom bap. And I always wanted to do a project that was based around doing a boom bap classic hip-hop record. Being as I'm from Washington, D.C., we never had a hip-hop group come out during that time, because we had our own local music called Go-Go, which dominated in the 90s. And we didn't contribute hip-hop artists that made it on a national platform as much as other cities did. So I kind of wanted to revisit the idea of what if Washington, D.C. had a classic 90s boom bap record. And that was the whole theme of the record. And I got together with two other MCs from D.C. by the name of XO and by the name of YU. And we formed a group called the Diamond District. D.C. is shaped like a diamond, and it's the District of Columbia, so that's the name, Diamond District. It's a slang term for D.C. And yeah, we came together with that theme, and little did we know that everyone else wanted that record too. It shot out from the internet, and it caught fire, and the attention we got, the tours we got, there's a lot of even things I'm not even at liberty to discuss now, but we've also already been courted by major labels for our second release, which we're working on right now. But it just took everyone by storm, and we got the thing that we really appreciated was the legends that we grew up listening to. They were the ones literally picking up the phones and calling us saying that they loved the record, and that meant so much to us. You know, shout out to De La Soul for that, you know, and so many others. Yeah, you know. Yeah.
So you get really good reviews.
Yeah.
It sounds like a real hip hop, but as of now it's really nice. It's coming in the world. It's coming in the world at the same time. You know, it's the fun music, but at the same time it's actually a really good map. But are you really satisfied with your work? And you still have no plans about making this kind of thing?
Sure. I'm a fan of themed records. I like a record to have a theme. I don't like to aimlessly create. I always get asked, will I do another series of Odd Seasons? But I definitely won't be. It's been explored. I've done it. I'm satisfied with it. I'll do another theme for sure. You know, my most recent themed record was Rock Creek Park, which is an instrumental album based around Rock Creek Park in Washington, D.C. And after that, there'll be another theme record. Diamond District was a theme record about boom bap from the mid-90s. Odd Seasons was a theme record about pairing music and emotion with the seasons changing. And Rock Creek Park, of course, was about very special place to me in Washington, D.C. And I'll know it when it hits me what the next theme will be, but there'll definitely be another theme record. Yeah. No, when I was creating Traveling Man, those tracks were created in the cities that they're called. You know, from touring, I make beats on the road. I have a laptop and I make all my beats on a laptop. So anywhere where I'm at, I just put my headphones on and I make beats. Train, plane, bus, you know.
So it's just you just named
the track. Well, I named the tracks in the cities that I made them. So when I if you listen to Stockholm, I made that in Stockholm. If you listen to Khartoum, I made that in Khartoum. Yeah. My equipment is pretty minimal. I use a laptop, and on my laptop is Pro Tools, and I make everything in Pro Tools. I make the beats in Pro Tools, I record vocals, and I mix. So I do the whole song in Pro Tools. I started working with Mellow Music Group, I think it was 2008, and the owner, Mike Toll, reached out to me to get some production, and he got a lot of production from me, and as I started to inquire what he was doing with this production, I learned that he was creating a compilation. So I told him, how about you let me get a little bit more involved in the selection of the artists over the beats, because I had that experience already with Have To. And he agreed, and the first project that came out with Mental Liberation was a success, and it did very well. Then he also had the idea to release a project that I had put out for free on the internet, and it was already a year old and available for free, but he said that there was still a buying market. And that was an idea that I had played around with also, and we soon discovered that even though we had put a record out for free and it was already out for a year, lots of people still wanted to buy it. And that sparked a different philosophy at Mellow Music, I think, that separates us a lot. Of we understand that we have to sell records because we're a record label, but selling records doesn't always have to be done in the traditional way anymore. There's lots of new ways to sell records. So we're very, very hands-on, we're very direct with our fans. And we give our fans a lot of music for free to gain their trust. And then they support us. And in exchange, we get to make more music for them. After a few successful projects, Mike Toll brought me on board to be a director of operations for Mellow Music. So I actually work for the same label I'm signed to. A lot of the things that I did for myself before, in the middle of Have To and Mellow Music, I booked tours for myself and did consulting and management and etc. He asked me to continue doing that and also do that for all the other artists on Mellow Music. So my position there is a very, very heavy one. Of I have to be an artist half the day, and I have to be on the business side the other half of the day. So Mike and myself, you know, we share a lot of the responsibilities. Even though in certain parts of the mainstream industry, especially in Europe, and I'm not too sure about Asia, I know that the preference for what they're listening to is changing away from underground hip-hop, but it's quite the opposite in the States. There's a huge renaissance occurring right now with underground hip-hop. More focus on lyricism is coming back. Even when the production styles from a lot of underground hip-hop are finding their way back into mainstream music. So I would definitely say that the rest of the world may be moving in a different direction, but it's quite the opposite here. And it's always been that way for me. I have always sold more records in the United States than anywhere else. You know, you get artists like today, like J. Cole and Drake and Kendrick Lamar, and these are all guys from the underground. These are all guys who focus on lyricism over beat breaks and sample-based production, but they're finding ways to incorporate that into the mainstream, and then the fans are now looking for that again. So I can't honestly say it's going downhill, at least not here. And here has always been my biggest market, so it's not really a concern for me. I'm in a good place with it. I think it's a great time. It's excellent.
Yeah.
all the, as I said before, Diamond District is being courted by major record labels, you know, because that sound is coming back in the States. So, yeah, it's a great time for me. Yeah. Ah, sure, sure. I'm always open to work with different genres of music. I love to do everything, you know. I use projects like The Odd Seasons in order to explore and experiment a bit. If you listen to those records, you'll see there's a lot of different styles of production on one record. I'm open to work with anybody on anything. I love being a musician first. Being a hip-hop artist second, but at first I'm just a musician. I just like music, you know. I'd like to score films. I'd like to get into a lot of bigger dynamic sounding music, a lot of alternative music and indie music. I'd like to explore, definitely. Well, I think that's one of the fundamental differences between the mainstream and the underground is We don't have to necessarily only write about what sells first, and we're not under control by a record label telling us what songs are approved and which songs are not approved. And that gives us the freedom to have songs of substance. You know, when you're trying to appeal to a lot of people, the more complex you get, the more niche you get, the smaller the groups of people you appeal to. It's a simple equation. If you want to appeal to the masses, you have to be as basic as possible in order to include everyone. But the minute you add some things and you get a bit more complex, you reduce the amount of people who can understand it. And you get a bit more complex, less people understand it, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. So I think a lot of mainstream music is simple because it has to be very, very broad. But underground music can be extremely complex because it's not broad. It's not designed for everyone to get it. There's going to be some people where my music completely goes over their head, where maybe my vocabulary is too much, or the way that my cadence and my rhymes, the way I write the lyrics, is a bit too stylized and not as simple and, you know, laid out for them. So it weeds away, it alienates a large amount of people. But that same freedom allows us to do what we want, you know, not worrying about appealing to as many people as possible.
So if you get a call from the mainstream, and definitely.
I'll probably have a lot of records released on major labels in 2012, but I've done it in such a way where I've been allowed to keep my own artistic integrity, because the major labels are understanding now that there is no longer a one-size-fits-all artist, that they can put all their money into one artist and he'll sell millions of records. Doesn't exist anymore. There's only several artists with smaller fan bases, and when you combine all of them, it creates a large amount. So they're allowing people to build their own cult followings, their own fan bases, and then they pick them up. So I have my following here, and there's another artist who has his following there. But if we're on the same record label, that label is making money from both of us. They understand that now. So they're not as eager to change an artist anymore as they used to be. But as I said, it's a great time right now. You know, it would be swinging drums, emotional, soulful, connected music that blends old and new. It's analog and it's electronic at the same time. And it's very emotional. It's always connected to emotion. And the drums always, my drums, I don't think make people's heads bob up and down. You move in a circle with my drums, you know? And that's what I think is something that defines my drums, my music. Odyssey Music isn't really a label. It's just a branding. It's a brand to let people know I put my stamp on this. If you see that it's Odyssey Music, then if you like my stuff, you're gonna like this. So there's a lot of new artists I work with that are unknown people. I love working with new, brand new artists that no one's ever heard of. And I want people to trust it, that it's gonna be good, and listen to it. So that's what'll get us, that will get branded as Odyssey Music, to let them know I've been involved. Because a lot of people take my beats and they rap over them and they put them out and they say produced by Odyssey, and I've never met them, I don't know them, and they use my name to promote it. But if you don't see Odyssey Music connected to it, then it's not me. They just took my music, you know. My largest inspiration is life itself. I love living, I love experiencing, you know, life. I love everything that comes with it, the good and the bad. And it's like, you know, our eyes are like a television that's on from the moment we wake up. And I'm constantly watching and observing and analyzing and absorbing. And I interpret that into music, you know. Sure. I'd have to say, right now, my favorite MC of all time is Jay-Z. My favorite MC right now is Drake. My favorite producer of all time is Jay Dilla. My favorite producer right now is Kanye. Definitely. That's what I want to work with. I'd love to work with Kendrick Lamar. I'd love to work with The Roots. There's so many. I'd love to work with Feist. That would be a dream. I'd love to work with Bon Iver. I'd love to work with Van Hunt. There's so many people who I'm fans of. My next solo album, entitled People Hear What They See, will be released on Mellow Music Group. As I said, with Diamond District, we already have some offers from major labels. And I'll definitely be doing some production for major label artists in 2012, and then I'll just take it from there. I'm not really in a rush to be signed to a major label. I'm in a very good position. You know, working for the label that you're signed to is a good position, you know. So I'm comfortable. You know, if they come with a really good deal, I'll consider it. 2012 right now involves the second release of Diamond District's album, March on Washington, is the name of that. My solo album, People Hear What They See. I'll be dropping several other artists in 2012. Brand new artists, Stick Figure from Kansas City, Tranquil from London, Olivier Desol from DC by way of London. YU, one of the members from Diamond District, we're gonna do a whole album together. Another instrumental album. I'll be dropping another compilation. I'm producing for everyone right now. I'm not really at liberty to say who I'm working with right now, but you'll see my production credits on a lot of albums in 2012. Put it to you this way, I've got to make 150 beats by March. Yeah.
Working every day.
Every day. Yeah. I'm already on 2013. Mellow Music has all their releases scheduled for the rest of the year. So we're working on 2013 right now. Yeah. I don't have any direct plans to work with any Asian artists because I've never been contacted by any. But if they hit me up, I'm down, you know? I don't do anything for free. But anyone hits me up with that freeness, you know, you don't even get a response. Shout outs. Much love to Hip Hop LE. Much love to the peoples of South Korea, you know, and much love to all the hip hop listeners tuning in, you know. Peace.